As you know, today the topic of both the talks is variational inference, and specifically I'm going to talk about the most common manifestation of variational methods, which is the mean field method. And the nice thing about this is that when it's applicable, it's fast, it's fairly accurate, and really easy to use. There are no real knobs to adjust, so you can use it in a pretty black box sense, especially as compared to something like Markov chain Monte Carlo, where you might have more twiggling to do. So it's a very nice general method that you can use sort of off the shelf. So first, the definition of variational inference is really broad. It's you have some sort of probability distribution, some exact, complicated, multivariable probability distribution. And it's exact, and that's good, but the problem is it's hard to work with. So you'd like to replace it with something tractable and easier to work with. And any time in which you're trying to do that and trying to find a distribution that's both tractable and a good approximation to the original one, it's called variational inference. The mean field approximation is the specific type of variational inference in which your approximate distribution is factorized. It's just a product of one factor for each of your original variables, or more generally, it's a product of factors each containing disjoint subsets of the variables. So it doesn't have to be P is approximated by Q of X1 times Q of X2. It could be Q of X1 and X2 and Q of X3, etc. So you often read in the literature the statement that variational Bayes exchanges inference for optimization. And what that means is that, let's say you have the exact probability distribution. In some sense, your problem is completely solved because you have a function, gives you a probability, and if you want to do stuff with it, like say you want to find the marginal distribution of X1, well, you have an explicit formula for that. It's just you integrate your exact probability with respect to X2 and X3 and X4, and once you integrate out all the other ones, you have the marginal for the first one. Or if you want to calculate an average, you multiply by the thing you're averaging and then integrate. So that's inference. It's basically tantamount to integration. But sometimes it can be hard because integrals need not to be easy, even if you can write them down explicitly. It might be an expensive or impossible quadrature, especially if you have a lot of variables. Whereas p-tractable, the definition of tractable is that it's easy to integrate, that it's inexpensive to take a marginal distribution or an average. And you can basically see that in the mean field case, from Fubini's theorem. If you want to integrate a product, it's the product of integrals, and so it's really fast and easy to do the inference problem. But you've exchanged it for optimization because now you don't know what tractable distribution to use. It's an optimization problem to find the one that best approximates your true distribution. Now, often that's a good trade-off to make because when you do an integral, you have to contend with the entire phase space. If there's some value that your variables can take on, you have to integrate over that. Whereas in optimization, you have some set of parameters you're optimizing over, and as long as you have some path through the phase space that reaches a peak, you're good. You don't have to worry about the other parts of your parameter space. Now, of course, you might have to hope that you found a global optimum, not a local one, and I'll gloss over that. But often that hope is true. So now we come to a slide that might confuse you a little bit. If you know my academic background, you might think I just had a LaTeX template and forgot to delete this slide. Because really, it seems like a non sequitur, just completely. And let me tell you my thought process. So I'm supposed to talk about variational inference. And the next speaker is talking about variational inference. And furthermore, the next speaker is considered a world authority on variational inference. So I decided to take the coward's way out and talk about physics instead, because that's my comfort zone. In all seriousness, this is a physical model, and I really am talking about it, but it is a statistical physics model, and it has a probability distribution associated with it, and we are going to handle that probability distribution with variational mean field theory. So I want to warn you, please don't zone out at the beginning of the physics part, and then zone back in when the physics ends, and you're saying, okay, now we'll be talking about probability. Because if you do that, you'll miss two-thirds of the talk. And I promise the physics is really just probability, as will become explicit really soon. So just bear with me. Here's the model we're going to talk about. It's called the Ising model. It's a very canonical toy model representing magnetism. And what it is you have a grid of little magnets, we'll call them spins for quantum mechanical reasons, and they can take on the values of up, which we'll call +1, or down, which we'll call a spin of -1. And in this model, the spins want to point the same way. They want to be like a piece of iron, you know, where all the little magnetic domains want to point together so that the iron can pick up paper clips. So what we'll say is that if two adjacent spins point the same way, we'll give it an energy of -1, because lower energy is a good thing here. If two spins point the opposite way, such as in the lower right corner of that diagram, we'll give it an energy of +1. And then the total energy of the system will be just the sum of those contributions from all pairs of adjacent spins. So on this slide, I have all of statistical physics. Really, all of it. And as you can see, there's probability written on it, so this is going to be our link to a probability problem. And what it says is that the probability of some configuration of a system, like some specific configuration of this one's up, this one's down, up, etc., is proportional to the exponential of minus the energy divided by temperature. And I could just give it to you and tell you to believe it, but I can't resist telling you the meaning of it, which is, first, nature doesn't like to be in a high energy state. So you see that as the energy increases, the probability is exponentially suppressed. But there's a caveat, which is that if you increase the temperature, this effect is dampened. You divide the exponent so that it becomes less negative. And what that means is basically the definition of temperature, which is ambient random energy available. If there's more random ambient energy available, a system can go into a high energy state. So if we plug that all of statistical physics on one slide into our model, we get the following probability distribution, which is up there, as a function of all of the spins in the system. And just to give some motivation for what we're doing, what we're looking for is a phase transition. So at high temperatures, what we'll expect this probability model to do is the energy will be divided by a large temperature, and it will have a small contribution. And so the system will tend to be random because there's less of that demand to be in a low energy state. Whereas at low temperatures, if you have an unfavorable energy configuration, you'll have E to a very, very bad negative number, it'll be highly suppressed. And so what things will want to do is all the spins will want to line up. Okay, so now we are going to apply mean field theory to this. Or I should say mean field variational inference. It's just called mean field theory in physics because you're not saying it's mean variational inference, but it actually is. So we have this probability distribution, and it's complicated and it's hard to work with, and it involves all these different variables in one big thing. As an aside, it's actually possible to solve it exactly, but let's pretend it's not, because usually these things are impossible. And what we want to do is approximate it as a factorized distribution with one univariate factor for each one of the little magnets. So I'm going to motivate this purely heuristically, just make a reasonable guess of what these individual factors should be, and then later we'll justify it. But right now, I think it will be intuitively reasonable to everyone, but it will not be at all justified. So let's think about how we could build these individual factors. So first, if we look at the conditional distribution for one of the spins, it only depends on the adjacent spins. So instead of contending with an infinite number of other spins, you just have to contend with its four neighbors. So this is a simplification. It's now a distribution that depends on a spin right here, and a spin here, and here, and here, and here. But that's still not a univariate distribution. So a reasonable thing to do, and again, I say reasonable, not justified or not rigorous, is to simply replace all the neighboring spins by their averages. So when you do that, you find that the univariate distribution for spin on site I depends on this parameter m. Oh, that should be an m sub I. I'm sorry about that. This parameter m, which is the sum of the averages of its neighbors. And that m stands for mean field, because it is the average influence from its neighbors on that one spin. Now, we have to know where that average comes from. And so to do that, we have to know the formula for if you have the factor q, how do you get the average? And so that's very easy to do, because remember, these spins can only take on two values, plus one and minus one. So we can just sum over both those possibilities and get the average. So that's this formula. If the spin is one, you get one times its probability. And then you have minus one times the probability of minus one. And if you remember your pre-calculus or calculus or wherever they teach you hyperbolic functions, that comes out to a hyperbolic tangent. So this suggests some sort of iterative scheme, right? Because we said if we want to know the univariate factor at this site, we need to know the averages of its neighbors. But to know the averages of the neighbors, we need to know their univariate factorized distributions. And so we start with some initial guess for what those are and then go back and forth iterate until hopefully it converges. So the procedure is start with some guesses for the average spins, calculate the mean field at each site, which is just the sum of its neighbors' averages, and then plug that into our hyperbolic tangent formula to get the new averages at every site. And I am not actually going to prove, or I'm not even positive it converges, but it seems like it should. And that's good enough for me. So anyway, just to give you something more tangible, let's say we have a large or an infinite system. You could add the further assumption that every site is equivalent to every other one. And so rather than each site having its individual average spin, they all share a common value of the average, which we'll call S bar. And in that case, we don't have a lot of update equations. We have one. And we can solve for what its fixed point should be, which is S bar is the hyperbolic tangent of 4 times S bar, the 4 coming from the fact that it has contributions from 4 neighbors, the one to the left, the right, up, and down. So we can solve that equation, and we can get something satisfying, which is a phase diagram, which is the average spin as a function of the temperature. And we get what we intuitively expected, which is at high temperatures, you see there's nothing. The average spin is 0 because it's totally disordered and random. And as the temperature gets smaller, it bifurcates, and you can either go to 1 or minus 1, which is due to the fact that either the spins are all completely lined up in the up way or completely lined up in the down way. And then in between, you have a descending amount of this average, which says that, yes, on average, they are all lined up, but because the temperature is not 0, there is still a bit of randomness in the system. And I want to point out now that if we had done something, say, maximum likelihood, we would have completely botched this. Because if you go back to our probability distribution, right here, this probability density is maximized uniquely by making everything point in the same direction. Regardless of temperature, that's still the maximum. So what maximum likelihood would have told you is that the phase diagram is just a line that goes forever, and you would completely miss the qualitative fact that at some point randomness takes over. And this will extend to any probability problem that has nothing to do with physics, namely that maximum likelihood methods can be qualitatively incorrect. And really, especially that's true if your probability distribution is not symmetrical, because let's say the maximum is here, and then it goes down or something. Maximum likelihood will always go at this one special point when it's more representative to take a mean or something that goes over here. So that can come up, for example, when you have a likelihood that depends on a variance and the maximum is at 0. And so max likelihood will say, oh, the variance is 0. You have an infinitely tight distribution, and it becomes pathological. So we see even now an example that we've avoided pathology. Now, for the people in the audience who are not physicists, I would like to pose a fun question, which is where in this phase diagram and for what temperature do you think our mean field approximation would be least reliable?
Zero.
Zero temperature? All right, that's a good. Any other guesses? Thank you for guessing.
The bifurcation.
It's a bifurcation. So John's right about this one. And I think he's not a physicist. So the reason is our mean field approximation, it's killing correlations between something and its neighbors. I mean, when you replace a neighboring spin by its mean, you are killing its individual identity and therefore eliminating correlations. And that's basically what the mean field theory does, is it says that I hope some correlations are not important. So over here in the phase diagram, that's okay to ignore correlations, because if everything's random, then if one of your neighbors decides to change its mind or something, the temperature's still so high that you're random. I'll make a jumping off the cliff analogy. So let's call S bar how much people want to jump off a cliff. So over here, everything's disordered, people are free thinking, and they're not influenced by their friends and peers, and therefore, if some guy decides to jump off a cliff, it's not really going to influence you. Now, over here, we're in a regime where everyone has decided that jumping off a cliff is a great idea, and if there's one person who's then free thinking and changes his mind, you're going to say, I don't care, the collective will is to jump off this cliff. Now, right here, when the populace is deciding, is jumping off a cliff a good idea? That's when correlations are important. Because if one of your best friends is like, you know, I'm doing it. This is a good idea. I've looked through it. You'll say, okay, that tips the scale. Don't mind if I do. So this over here is where correlations are actually going to be important. But in most of the phase diagram, this is a nice approximation. Okay, so now that we've done something and solved the problem but not justified it, let's deconstruct what we did and try to figure out what was the general recipe underlying this process. So we had an exponential, e to the si times sj, where I and j were neighbors. And it seems really, really obvious the rule that we were following. If we replaced sj by its average, so the general rule has to be take the full probability distribution, and if you want to get the factor I, just replace all the other variables by their averages. I mean, right? How could it be anything besides that? Okay, and so obviously with my tone of voice, that's wrong. It turns out that we did something else. So the best way to read this formula would be from right to left. So first, we took the full multivariable probability distribution. We took its natural logarithm. Then we averaged it with respect to all the other variables, and then we re-exponentiated it. And you can see for this example that that does in fact give the same result, because you have e to the SISJ. Take log, you get SISJ. Take the average with respect to everything that's not I, and you get SI times the average of SJ. And then re-exponentiate, and you do get what we did. But we're going to show that this lower thing is actually, in some sense, the right rule. Okay, so I think many of you know that my style is I like to push off the math until as late as possible and have the intuition loaded in front. And anyway, this is now the math part. It's going to be about two slides. It's not very bad. So here it is. It all starts from an inequality. And that comes back to what Yossi says about, wait, converging is something increasing. Basically, the answer is yes, because we'll phrase it in terms of a lower upper bound and trying to maximize and get close to that bound. So it starts from 0 equals the natural log of 1. So far, so good. And 1 is the integral of a probability distribution, because probability distributions are normalized. So far, this is just an equality. And this is also an equality because you can multiply something by 1, q divided by q. So here, we're using the same notation where p is the original exact distribution and q is our approximating distribution. So far, this has nothing to do with mean fields. It's just variational approximations in general. Now, finally, at the last step, we get to an inequality. And it's Jensen's inequality for concave functions, which says that if you take a concave function of an average, that is going to be greater than the average of the concave function. So in this case, we are averaging the quantity P over Q with respect to the probability distribution Q and taking the log of that average. And so that will be greater than the average with respect to Q of the log of this quantity. So what you can see from this equality, this inequality, is that if your approximating distribution Q is exactly equal to the original one, it becomes an equality. So it becomes exact and you actually achieve the bound. So what that suggests is that what you want to do is maximize the thing on the right-hand side, and that is the way to objectively and rigorously choose the best approximate distribution Q. Now, I put best in quotes because it's not objectively the best. It maximizes one particular criterion, and it might not be the ideal or correct or optimal one. I mean, most likely there is no correct thing to maximize. But let's look a little bit at exactly what we're maximizing. So let's suppose that our approximate distribution Q is big, has a lot of weight in a region of space where our original one is small. So then P divided by Q is going to be a small number. Natural log of that is going to be a small negative number. And so when that goes in the integral, you're getting penalized heavily. So what this does is it penalizes Q for putting a lot of weight where P does not have much weight. Conversely, let's suppose that Q is small in a place where P is large. So in that case, your natural logarithm has some big contribution. You're taking the log of a big thing instead of a small thing, but is multiplied by Q, which we supposed is small. So this is actually not penalized. So what this formulation of variational Bayes is doing is trying its hardest to make the approximate distribution fit inside the original distribution. You could imagine a different criterion where you flip the roles of P and Q and said, I want the original distribution to fit inside the approximate one. You say, if there's probability density in the original one, I don't want to miss it. And if you do that and optimize that, you would be doing expectation propagation. And it's a completely valid alternative. This is the blue collar way of saying we are minimizing the KL divergence, KL of Q, P. And expectation propagation would be the KL divergence of P, Q. Just a different definition. So it's, you can say, I want to minimize the information that's contained in Q and not P, or you can say, I want to minimize the information that's contained in P and not Q. So now let's see what this comes out to for our specific choice of a mean field approximation. And for simplicity, without any loss of generality whatsoever, let's just make it a two-variable distribution. It's really just for notational convenience. So if we plug in trying to approximate P by Q of X times Q of Y, we get that quantity. And it's a function of a function, right? Because Q of X is some probability distribution, it's a function. So when you're trying to optimize a function of a function, you take a functional derivative and set it to zero. So if you have seen it, wonderful, you've seen it. If you haven't, it's kind of like a regular derivative, and you could, in this particular case, you could be very naive and do what you know about regular derivatives, and it would all work out. The other thing is that there's a constraint here, because the thing you're optimizing has to be a normalized function, so it integrates to one. And so, therefore, you have a functional derivative combined with a Lagrange multiplier, and you get this, which is exactly the formula that we stated earlier is the, quote, right way to do variational Bayes. Namely, you take the logarithm of the exact distribution, take the expectation with respect to all the other variables, and then re-exponentiate. So that means we have derived a recipe for variational Bayes, which is really just a restatement of the recipe for the Ising model that we said earlier. Namely, you initialize all of your factor distributions. And then you just keep iterating the process of whenever you want to get one of the factors, you take the log of the full probability distribution, average with respect to all the other distributions, and then re-exponentiate. And you hope it converges. And in this case, it's better than hope. You know it will converge because we are always increasing towards that that bound that we derived earlier. Now, it's not guaranteed to converge to a global maximum. That's a separate story. But it is going to converge, and that's nice. So I'd like now to discuss a very canonical example of... Oh, yes, Hillary.
Can I ask a question on the last slide?
Yeah, of course.
Trying to get P as a product of Q is that Q would be the marginal. But that's not what you're doing here, because in the easy model case, all the marginals are 50, 51, minus 1.
And so, yes.
So am I understanding right that part of the advantage is that if you have an iterative algorithm, you can get to more than one point in the space instead of averaging across them, or something like that?
That's a really, really excellent point. So what Hillary's saying about the Ising model, she's also correctly pronouncing it as easy, and she's right about that. No, you're right. I'm saying no one does it, but it is easy. She's saying that what if you didn't do something approximate? What if you just exactly marginalized all the other spins? Then just by symmetry, you would say that this one spin is equally likely to be up or down, and so it's a 50-50 bimodal distribution. So you're right. What variational Bayes is doing, this comes back to what we're maximizing. So this is a bimodal distribution. One mode is everything's up, one mode is everything's down. So what we said is that variational Bayes is trying really hard to fit inside the exact distribution. So what it wants to do is fit inside one of those modes. It'll either choose they're all up or to choose they're all down, but it doesn't want to try to compromise and straddle both of them, because then it would have a lot of probability weight in the middle, which is what our objective is penalizing. Now, in a lot of cases, when bimodality comes from an identifiability issue, they're sort of equivalent by symmetry, and so you don't really mind if you only have one of them. And in this case, that's true. There are other cases where you have a bimodal distribution and you do care about both the modes and they're not equivalent, and then variational Bayes simply misses them. So, great point. So, sort of the canonical example of when you should think to try variational Bayes is usually a hierarchical model. So the general hierarchical graphical model is that you've got this high-level hyperparameter called lambda, and then it has children parameters called theta. In the plate notation, that means we have a bunch of these theta. And then each of those has data associated with it and some likelihood. And the reason that mean field theory is going to be justified here is basically the law of large numbers. So if you have this lambda and it's talking to a lot of thetas, then if any individual theta is changed by a little bit, it's sort of going to be washed out in the average over all of them. And so therefore, simply because lambda is attached, or by attached I mean connected with an arrow, to so many theta, it's not going to be correlated all that much with any individual one. It's essentially the same thing as saying your vote doesn't count. But I mean, I actually personally do vote. I just want to, I'm not that cynical, but it's just, I like analogies. So that's why you should think this is okay. If you only had one parameter, it would be a pretty stupid thing to do. But if you have 100,000, suddenly this becomes a much better idea. And so this is simply plugging in the variational mean field update formulas that we had earlier. And it's relatively simple. Yeah?
So is it true that inasmuch as there is covariation between the theta j and that's violating this
It's, you mean among the theta j and each other?
Yeah.
So when you think about it, by the structure of this graphical model, they're conditionally independent given the hyperparameter. So if the hyperparameter is not correlated much with the J, and you are can therefore sort of sever the correlation between lambda and theta, then you get along for free that the thetas are also weakly correlated. They can, in this model at least, they can only be correlated insofar as they're mutually correlated with lambda. And one thing to note here is that if you have some sort of conjugate exponential model, this is blazingly fast because your original probability and the likelihoods and everything are these exponentials. You take a log of it and you get something that's, say, linear or quadratic or easy to work with. Taking an expectation value of that is very fast because expectation values in exponential models are analytic. And so it's really just algebra. There's no integration or averaging involved except insofar as you plug in an algebra formula. So people love to do this for conjugate exponential models. But I believe, as Dave is going to talk about, you don't have to do it in that scenario too. You can use other methods. I think you're talking about that. But we'll see. So before going on to questions, I'd like to conclude with a few general observations about this approach. So the first is that if you're familiar with the expectation maximization algorithm, you might have noticed that some of these things look very similar to that. Because after an expectation, what we do is we take an E step where we get the Q for one of the variables, the length variable. And then in the M step, we take the original likelihood, we take its log, we average it with respect to that Q, that E step posterior, and then we maximize it. So here the difference is we take the log likelihood, we average it with respect to the E step, and we re-exponentiate to get a distribution. So in some sense, in this model, in this approach, we have the EM algorithm, but everything has an E step because everything has a distribution. Or the other way of saying it is that the EM algorithm is a special case of variational Bayes, where some of the things with M steps, are assumed to have an infinitely narrow distribution. So what that means is that mean field variational Bayes is strictly more accurate than EM because it's a less constrained thing you're optimizing over. It makes fewer assumptions. And in particular, any case where maximum likelihood will be pathological, you will want to do variational Bayes instead of EM. Now, another thing to note is that I phrase this in terms of the sort of exact update equation, where you find the maximum you can do for one of these factor distributions. But because what you're doing is maximizing some objective which has a bound on it, you know that as long as you keep increasing, even if you don't do the best, go all the way on one iteration, you are still going to converge and you're still going to improve your objective function. So what that means is you could improve your objective, the thing you're trying to maximize, in gradients, say, or you could do it stochastically, and that will also get you where you're going. And when you don't have conjugate exponential distributions, that might be essential because suddenly these updates do involve integrals and they might be hard to do, but if you do it with gradients and stochastically, it's more of a black box approach. So the way I like to think of it is that variational inference with stochastic gradients is sort of analogous to autograd when you're talking about neural networks. It's a black box way of optimizing it without thinking too hard and without assuming any nice conjugate exponential structure. Final thing I want to note is that the examples I showed, you factorized this distribution completely. You gave one factor to every variable. But you don't have to do that. You could do block factorization where some factor contains a lot of the variables. And so one example where you would really want to do that would be if you were doing an HMM in a Bayesian way. So here we have our familiar HMM, a sequence of hidden states in the red box. And we have some latent some parameter that controls the emission likelihood, some parameter that controls the prior, and some parameter that controls the transition matrix. So in this case, the bad thing to do would say our factorized distribution equals a Q of A times a Q of pi times a Q of pi times a Q for this and a Q for this and a Q for this, etc. That would be really, really, really silly and kind of a crime because for HMMs, you have the wonderful machinery of the forward-backward algorithm where you can get the posterior for all of these jointly in one fell swoop. So what you would want to do there is exploit that fact, exploit that you have the forward-backward algorithm, and factor it as a factor for this, a factor for this, a factor for this, and a factor for all of these at once. Because if you can do it, and it's more accurate, then why not do it? So that's everything that I wanted to say about mean field variational Bayes. All right, thank you, everyone.
I'm Dave Blei. I'm going to talk about modern variational inference. Thanks very much for inviting me. And also thanks to David for that incredibly clear and wonderful and also hilarious introduction talk. When you spun around and said, "I'm not a magnet, I'm still not a magnet," that was like the funniest thing I've seen at a lecture in 15 years. I would steal it if I could pull it off. Okay, so I'm going to talk about modern variational inference, and I was happy to be invited, and then I think they told me it's a chalk talk, and I was happy to give a chalk talk, so I spent a lot of time preparing some notes. It was a great chance to kind of synthesize some ideas, and I'd like to keep it very casual, so please interrupt me with questions. We'll start out with some slides, and then I'll move to the board to give the details, and I'm happy to get through some or all or none of my prepared remarks. Okay, so first, just an overview of some things that we've been doing in my group. This is a picture of overlapping communities discovered in a big network of U.S. patents. So we have U.S. patents, they cite each other, and we want to find overlapping communities of these patents, okay? Or you have Facebook, people connect to each other, you want to find overlapping communities in a big network. You know some people from school, some people from the chess club, some people from your neighborhood. These are topics found in 1.8 million articles from the New York Times. So each of these nodes in this picture is a group of words associated under a single theme. You can see here stock, percent, companies, fund, market, bank. And the idea is that an algorithm ingested 1.8 million articles from the New York Times and uncovered these patterns of words that occur together. And the key point here is that this was done with a very large data set of documents. So this is called a topic model, and the idea is that you take a big unorganized collection of documents, uncover these patterns of words, and then use these patterns to give you understanding about your document collection, help you navigate it or form predictions, et cetera. This is going to be the running example of today's talk. It's a population analysis of a lot of genetic measurements, and I'll get into detail about this. But for now, this is the famous Pritchard Stevens Donnelly model also, I'm going to use some words like allele and locus.
You're okay.
Yeah. Okay. You're okay. No. I was going to say I don't have a complete grasp of what those words mean. I'm going to have a lot of imposter syndrome every time I say the word allele. And correct me, or if I'm making a grave mistake, but otherwise, you know, let it go, the fuzz around the definitions of those words. So my understanding of this is that, I don't know, right, okay, here's my understanding. We have genomes, and they're the result of these ancestral populations that were roaming around the earth many, many years ago, having babies, and it led to this room. And so each of us...
That's definitely true.
Yeah, okay, definitely good. True. So far, so good. And so each of us, our genomes, reflects these ancestral populations and how they mixed over thousands and thousands of years. And from our observed genomes, we want to uncover the statistical signature, the genomic signature.
If I could add just a minor gloss.
Thank you.
It's actually a million years.
A million years,
And much of the allelic variation in humans really is a million years old. So you are walking around, my friend, with lots of stuff that's pre-human.
You know, I have felt that way for a long time. So, good, right. millions of years, and we want to uncover the genomic signatures of these ancestral populations. And so here is an analysis. Each of these little blocks is a group of people that are from the same place, and each of these colors represents the proportion of the discovered ancestral populations that we are attributing to each of these people. And again, the point is this is on a very large data set of people's genes. Here is a neuroscience analysis, something I also don't know much about, of 220 million fMRI measurements. Here, the idea was we took this big, high-dimensional fMRI data set of measured on people as they were doing different psychological experiments in the scanner, and then tried to find significant locations of activity in the brain and then how they correlated under different conditions. Again, the point is it's a very large-scale data analysis problem. Taxi rides. I know about these. But not this particular case, because this is in Porto. This is in a city in Portugal. 1.7 million taxi trajectories. We want to find patterns. Where do people go in Portugal? This is, I don't know how important this problem is. What are different types? What's that? Yeah, but what are the different types of taxi rides that people take? Maybe for stoplights and things like that. Anyway, a complex model of taxi rides fit to very many taxi rides, and this was done using a probabilistic programming language called STAM, which I'll tell you about in a second. Okay, why did I, in a half-baked way, tell you about all those things? Well, they all go through this process that I call the probabilistic pipeline. If you're a statistician or machine learner, this is going to maybe even seem vacuous to you, but I find it helpful to think about solving applied problems with data this way. We take our knowledge of the world and use it to make assumptions about the world, and those assumptions involve observations and hidden variables, hidden quantities that we believe exist and interact in order to lead to the observations that we made or the measurements that we made. We then take those assumptions and our data, our real data that we observed, and square them together to discover patterns. To discover what the hidden variables are that live inside of our observed data. And then finally, we use those discovered patterns to form predictions and explore. So in the case of that Pritchard-Stevens-Donnelly model, you know, we have all the observed genomes. We use the model to infer and we assume that there were some number of ancestral populations. We then use the observed genetic data and the model assumptions to uncover what the specific ancestral populations were that underlie our data. And then we use those to do things like correct for confounding or whatever it is we're doing downstream. Okay, this pipeline separates making assumptions, doing computation, and then applying the results of those computations. And like I said, it makes it easier to collaborate on applied data analysis problems. Now today, we're talking about the algorithms behind this process. And I didn't mention that each of those pictures that I showed you is an example of running through this pipeline, either with taxis or with documents or with social networks or with brain analysis or with genes. The key algorithmic problem is inference. This is what David spoke about for an hour this morning, right? What does the model I assumed, what does it say about the data that I observed? That's the inference problem. And what I want to talk about today is when we are going through this pipeline, how to solve the inference problem in general and in a scalable way. Okay. In particular, we're going to talk about variational methods where inference becomes an optimization problem. And I think you had a quotation in your talk around those same lines. Here I am asserting it in the same way. And I want to talk, after giving you an introduction to variational inference, about how to scale up variational inference with something called stochastic variational inference, and if there's time, how to generalize variational inference with black box variational inference. Actually, let me just be clear what I mean. Scale up variational inference means, you know, 50 years ago I had small data sets, and 20 years ago I had small data sets, and the computers could handle what I was doing. But nowadays we have massive data, and so we need algorithms that scale up to these massive data sets that can discover patterns from complicated assumptions with massive data. That's what I mean by scaling up inference. Generalizing inference is this. You probably know, statistics and machine learning usually works this way. That, or at least it works this way for me. scientist comes in, not him, but scientist comes into my office and says, hey, I've got this data set. It's, you know, all this fMRI data. And then we go to the whiteboard and we discuss the kinds of assumptions that she might want to make about that data. Okay, and we usually end up drawing lots of pictures like this with lots of graphical models that describe the interactions and the kinds of latent variables that she wants to assume. Then she leaves, and my grad students and postdocs and I derive an algorithm to take what was left at the whiteboard when she left and square it with the data that she then emailed us later on. Okay, that's discovering the patterns. And deriving the algorithm to do that takes between, you know, 1 month and 5 years. Then, after we've derived the algorithm, implemented, debugged it, and analyzed her data, we call her back, and she's totally forgotten about the meeting. We want to lubricate this pipeline, right? We want so that we can write down models and then somehow much more quickly get an algorithm out that we can use on the models that we write down. And that's what I mean by generalized variational inference. I want to be able to write down any model and not spend 5 years deriving the particular variational inference algorithm for that model before being able to use it. And that leads to the piece of this picture that I have not put here, which is that we then want to check our models, right? So once we've discovered patterns in data and predicted and explored, if that takes 10 years, you're committed at this point, you're married to your model, and you have to write a paper about it. But if this were lubricated, then we could check our model, go back, revise the assumptions, and go through this loop. Hey, this is really the goal.
So you can generalize what
you publish. That's right, sorry. Well, you've already published the entire everything there is to know about graphical models. And so now we are stuck, and then I want to do the same thing for inference algorithms. Yeah. Good. Yeah.
How does this relate to the data? Like, you know, every data set has got its set of biases and confounds and challenges that kind of confound your analysis. And so that 5-year arc is because of that, not because of necessarily, like, getting the data to run a lot of the time?
Well, I'm not sure. So I love your question, and that's the question that I think we should be asking over and over again and answering. Oh, sorry, thank you. The question was, I loved it. I don't know what it was. The comment was that a lot of that 5 years is about really understanding what these assumptions we want to make about the data are and dealing with confounders and things like that. But when you write down a complex model, the work is actually in just fitting the model and lubricating this pipeline so we can think about that. So we can think about what assumptions, try different assumptions out with the data. We can't do that now because every time we get to this box, the computation box, we need to sit down and rederive a new variational inference algorithm.
Comment. Obviously, a lot of the work isn't developing algorithms around here, but also, echoing Ben, even though we have well-developed algorithms that solve the problem very well on clean data, there's still a ton of work to do. Because the data lands on your desk, and it ain't clean, and stuff has gone wrong, and it's unreasonable to build black box things that will automatically clean up the stuff that goes wrong because it's very often a new thing has come up.
Yes. I agree. So I have a separate talk that I've not yet prepared that's about a subject I care a lot about, which is robustness. Yeah. So I think that there's a whole other talk, which is about how do I take these models that I'm building and make them robust to the idiosyncratic data that necessarily arises more and more and more and more as these data sets get large, right? It's true. If I had a table of 100 people and 7 measurements on each, I can sit there, I can find the outlier by eye and figure out what happened. Go call up the guy and say, did you really answer the question? No, you didn't. Okay, good. I'm going to change it. But right, when you have massive data sets, the exception becomes, you know, something that you need to handle automatically, and robustness in modeling is where we get there. And I'm happy to talk about it later to tell you about some of the ideas that we've been talking about in that sense. Here, what I mean by black box is not solving the problem of finding the right assumptions for the data automatically. That's a different problem, and I think it's hard. Here, by black box, I mean I don't, like Nir says, I am no longer needed here to derive the algorithm, that there is a computer program on your computer where you can write down the model, and that computer program derives the algorithm for you. So black box in that sense. Okay, so the two ideas, in case we never get to them, I'll give you the punchlines right now. Stochastic variational inference. This is how to scale up variational inference. So classically, if I have a model and I have a big data set, say of people's genomes, the variational Bayes that David spoke about eloquently just before me does something like this. Starts out with some random idea of what these ancestral populations are in the data, painstakingly analyzes each person according to that random idea of those ancestral populations. Seems like a waste of time. And then updates the idea of the ancestral populations. Okay, this is like the EM algorithm. Go through all your data, update your parameters, go through all your data, and so on. This is inefficient when you have large data sets because if you have a million sequenced people, you start out with no idea what's going on in the data, you waste your time analyzing each person according to that random, those random parameter estimates. Stochastic variational inference has this structure. I subsample, I grab a few people from that data set, I understand how they exhibit these ancestral populations, I then update my idea of the ancestral populations, and I repeat. Hey, this is much, much faster. Black box variational inference, I think this picture describes what I already said to you. I have any model, I have massive data set, I have reusable variational families, you'll understand what that means in a little bit, and out of my black box comes a conditional distribution of hidden variables given the observations without requiring me and my students to work on it. That's the idea behind black box. Okay, and finally, I want to mention, John asked about, you know, how could somebody start playing with these ideas. My student, Dustin Tran, has just released something called Edward, a library for probabilistic modeling, inference, and criticism. And this is meant to be a kind of software laboratory for playing with variational inference methods. And I recommend you check it out. If you know Stan, well, I won't go back to it. Oh, yeah, there it is. Stan is another piece of software that has variational inference algorithms implemented in it by Alp Kutcher-Kelbier. And that's another way that you can start playing with these algorithms, where in Stan you can write down your model as a program and then compile it into an inference algorithm and see what happens. Edward lets you do the same thing. It's a bit more extendable and a little more experimental. Okay, so the running example today will be this famous model, the admixture model of Pritchard, Stevens, and Donnelly from 2000. And we developed something called Terra Structure, which is a fast inference algorithm for this PSD model. So I call it PSD, Pritchard, Stevens, Donnelly. We is Prem Gopalan, Wei Hao, me, and John Story. And so I want to just show you a couple results, and then we'll get into the details of variational inference, and we'll go to the board. Here is one figure from our tech report. You can find it on the bio archive. These are these ancestral population plots, like I showed you earlier. And what we did was we created some synthetic data, right? Here is the synthetic data we created. And it's called Oracle. These are the true ancestral populations underlying this fake group of people that we made. And here we are doing inference with our method and two other methods on 10,000 individuals. Okay, and you can see that we're all loosely finding the exact population structure in this synthetic group of people. When you scale up, however, to 100,000 individuals and to 1 million individuals, these existing procedures, fast structure and the original admixture, can't complete their analysis. But Terra Structure does and remains equally accurate. Okay, that's the idea. The idea is that we want to scale up probabilistic models of genetic data to millions of people, and we can do that with these kinds of tools. Okay, I think I'm going to skip this in order to get to the point, but basically this algorithm is fast, it's accurate, so these are more synthetic examples. I will skip this. This says the same thing that I said before. We subsample data, we say something about that subsample, update our idea of the hidden structure in the data, and repeat. And the whole point of today's lecture at the Blackboard is to understand, why does Terra structure work? How did we do this? Yeah?
So when you say subsample, I saw the word subsample is stiff in that.
Mm. I'm going to gloss over that later, too. In what I'm going to describe to you at the board, we're going to subsample the rows, but actually we subsample the columns. I'll explain why at the right time. Okay, so this is the outline for the chalk talk. Introduction to variational inference, coordinate ascent variational inference, coordinate ascent variational inference for the PSD model. The scalable version builds on the coordinate-wise version. Scalable inference with stochastic variational inference, SVI for the PSD model, and then black box variational inference. And I thank John now for, I had like six more topics in this originally, and I sent him the notes yesterday, and he said, hey, that's too much, and he was right. So I don't need to get through all of this. I'm happy to get to just one and two, and one and two and three, and so on. Please keep interrupting me. It's fun. Okay. Good. Let's go to the board. So to start with, David started with physics, and we're going to start with Bayesian statistics. So we're going to do Bayesian statistics here, where x are observations. I think these are measurements. Z are latent or hidden variables. And alpha are fixed hyperparameters, things that are fixed in our model. And the core idea behind Bayesian statistics, of course, is to set up a model, which is a joint distribution of x and z, given some fixed stuff. And z is everything hidden, x is everything observed. And our goal is to do inference, to compute p of z. Ooh, bad. Do you spit at it? Or? Okay, that's great. Thank you. Goal is to do inference p of z given x. What is the latent ancestral population structure given the observed phenotypes that I've seen? This is the posterior. Okay, p of z of x, as you all know, just from the definition of conditional probability, I'm going to drop alpha just because we don't need it usually, is p of z comma x, the model, divided by p of x, the marginal probability of the observations. And p of x, can you see down here? No, okay. P of x is just, not just, this is the whole crux of the matter. P of x is the marginal probability of x, where you marginalize out the hidden variables. The notation is pretty loose, but that's the idea. You don't need that. All right, this is just the marginal probability of the observations. This thing is hard to work with. And this is why Bayesian inference is hard in complicated models. In the easing model that David talked about, and then we all learned how to pronounce it. I also say Ising model, but I also say Jensen's inequality instead of Jensen's inequality. But anyway, in the easing model, it is this normalizing constant that is also what's hard to compute about the easing model. Now, why is this hard? Well, when you imagine elaborate latent structures that, that govern your data, then here, what you have to do is sum over all the possible configurations of those latent structures. So in the case of population genetics, what this integral is over every possible population proportion for people, as well as all the possible parameters of those populations. And this is either analytically possible and exponentially hard to do, or it's not even analytically possible. And usually there are actually two sides of the same coin, but that's a detail. Okay, so this is the goal of Bayesian statistics, is inference. Compute the posterior, and the problem is that this marginal distribution is not possible to compute. Now, for a long time, Bayesian statistics focused on figuring out which models we could compute these posteriors with exactly. Right, this was the idea, and this is where things like conjugate exponential families and conjugate models come from. Thinking about, okay, I want to do Bayesian statistics. I want to have some kind of distribution over the hidden structure that underlies my data, and then that means that inference becomes a question of the posterior. In which joint distributions can I compute this posterior? Since the 1990s, since the early 90s, computation has revolutionized Bayesian statistics. The goal of modern Bayesian methods is to figure out trackable ways to approximate this posterior. So methods like Laplace's method, MCMC, important sampling, ABC, these are all computationally intensive methods for approximating a posterior distribution. And I made a joke about frequentists, but I also think that change in the 80s and 90s, where through computation we could start tractably approximating posteriors in Bayesian models that we couldn't otherwise work with, that changed the nature of Bayesian statistics too. It's no longer a grandiose philosophical debate about being Bayesian or frequentist. Rather, Bayesian statistics is about developing expressive probability models. And then these methods let us compute under those probability models and make inferences about complicated things like ancestral populations. Okay, so let's get into the PSD model as a concrete example. So this is the model of Pritchard et al., 2000. I'm out of my comfort zone, but I've heard it have many names, like some people call it the admixture model, the structure model. I call it the PSD model because it's easy to say. And let me write down the PSD model for you as a Bayesian model. And we'll do it over here. Okay. Is everybody happy with the Bayesian statistics setup? Okay, good. So I indexes individuals. L is a locus on the genome. Do you also say location on the genome?
No.
No, locus.
We say loci. If you say loci, I'll like some words.
Loci. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll remember that. Lo-fi, loci.
Loci is probably correct.
The data. Here, I'm going to talk about something I'm putting under the rug. Are YILM and YILF. Okay? M and F stand for mom and father. And these are the alleles that individual I has at locus L from her mom and from her dad. Okay? So this is going to be a simplification of the model in the paper. This is, of course, phased data. And in the paper, we work with unphased data, all right? But to give a tutorial about variational inference, it's much easier to work with this case where we have phased data, although in reality, when we have millions and millions of individuals, we're going to have unphased data, and that the paper is about an algorithm for unphased data. And I can allude later to what the difference is between the two algorithms. Okay, but so let's assume phased data. All right, so that's our data. And now we're going to impose some latent structure on this data. What is the latent structure? Okay, so first, we're going to assume K is the number of populations, right?
Millions of years ago, there were K populations roaming around the Earth having babies. And each one is described by a per locus distribution of alleles. Okay? And so beta sub K comma L is the distribution of alleles for population K at locus L. We're going to draw a graphical model in a second. And so you can imagine for the fifth population, there, and let's say there's a million SNPs, there's a million distributions over GATC. Those are the right letters? Very good. Okay. So I'm going to, actually, this is, forget that these are the, that's the ancestral populations. All right, so now let's describe the joint distribution, and we're going to describe the joint distribution in terms of the generative process of the data. All right, so that's one way to describe the joint, is to describe the process by which you imagine the data arise, the data here being the phased genotype data. Okay, so here's the PSD model. First, for each population, we are going to draw, I feel like that might be too low for you. So for each population, okay, so for each population, the distribution over alleles for each population and locus, we generate the distribution over alleles. Okay, so I just ran from a Dirichlet distribution. So Dirichlet distribution, just to remind you, is a distribution on distributions. So in this case, this is going to be a Dirichlet that produces distributions of four elements. And we're going to draw a distribution of four elements for each location and each population. Okay, so that's how we are creating the ancestral populations. And then for each individual, I'm going to first choose her population proportions, right? So here's theta I comes from a Dirichlet with parameter alpha. All right, so this is a k-dimensional Dirichlet. This produces that I am part Hungarian, part African, part European, okay? This is the distribution over the population proportions for individual I. Then, for each locus on individual I, what am I going to do? Well, here's what Pritchard, Stevens, and Donnelly do. They're first going to choose what we're going to call a population assignment. Okay, so Z, I can tell we're not going to get to anything today. Theta I, it's my fault, ILF. Comes from theta I. So what we're going to do is we're going to decide, okay, I'm a mixture of Hungarian, African, and what I said didn't make any sense, Hungarian, African, and European. I'm a mixture of European and African, let's say. And so I'm going to now choose for locus 31 that my mom, what I got from my mom comes from my African side, and what I got from my dad comes from my European side, for example. Okay? But this can get switched. This is no, we're not making any claims that this model is right in any way. Okay, so these are the population assignments. And now I'm finally going to generate my data. Okay, where I generate my data from the corresponding ancestral population distributions that I drew. Okay? So I hope this is clear. This is the Pritchard-Stevens-Donnelly model. It's basically, I like to call this a mixed membership model, right? So each individual's genome comes from a mixture model, right? These come from a mixture model where the mixture components are shared across individuals, but the mixture proportions are change from individual to individual. Okay, this is basically a mixed membership model of genotype data. Okay, as you know, we like graphical models. And so let's draw the graphical model of this model. Okay, so here are, actually let's start over here. Okay, so these are the ancestral populations. Here is the individual population proportion. When I'm teaching, I don't mind not getting through my lecture because there's always next week. It's actually a good thing.
Well, there's MIT on Friday.
That's right. We can just keep going. all right. So, all right. YILF, YILM. Okay. So here's a graphical model where I'm shading these nodes to indicate that they're observed. Everything else is hidden. And now, clear about where the replicates are. It's interesting in this case. So I have k different populations, right? So that means that this means I have k different population distributions for each locus. I have L loci. So this means I am replicating this little structure L times, but here I'm replicating it L times within my n individuals. Okay, so I've got n individuals. And I like to put hyperparameters on things. Okay, so great. This is the graphical model for the Pritchard-Stevens Donnelly. We like graphical models in machine learning. I think you do too, because they can tell us all of the conditional dependencies and independencies that we are assuming whether or not we like it based on this model, number one. Number two, from graphical models. So when a scientist walks into my office, we usually write something like this on the board at the end of the day. We can read off the algorithm that lets us fit this model, that lets us infer all of these hidden variables given these observations. Let me make them more like observations. Okay, but again, the problem, just like the problem for general Bayesian statistics, is that the posterior distribution of beta, z, and theta is intractable to compute. Okay, we can't compute it. Yeah. And here, actually, it's a detail, but the reason it's intractable is that, one, it's either tractable and we sum over exponential number of configurations of which populations each person's alleles came from, or, two, we have a continuous integral that we cannot tractably compute because of its mathematical form. Okay, good. That's the running example. Now let's talk about variational inference. Good. Variational inference. So let's return to our kind of general notation where z is latent variable. I know that collides with the notation for the Pritchard-Stevens-Donnelly model. The main idea behind variational inference, as David mentioned before, is that we are going to posit a family of distributions over the latent variables. Okay, so just to be clear, we're now in this z, the z is going to be all the latent variables. We posit a family of distributions over z, q of z, that has variational parameters nu. Okay, so this is a freely parameterized distribution over the latent variables. I was going to drink this. And the idea is that we want to find the value of nu. So I have this space, this index is a distribution over my latent variables. I want to find a value of nu that leads to a q that is close to the posterior that I care about. That's the idea. Closeness in mean field variational inference is measured with KL divergence QP. And so now we have an optimization problem on our hands. I have got this big space of q's. Each point in that space is indexed by a different setting of the variational parameters nu. And I want to traverse this space to find the member that's closest to p of z given x, the posterior that I care about. Okay, then once you found that, you use v star, nu star, as a proxy for that posterior. And that fitted variational distribution can be used to form predictions about the future, to explore your data, and so on. Okay, so this is what we mean when we say it turns inference into optimization. Set up a freely parameterized family, set up an objective function, KL divergence, and then optimize the parameters of the family to be close in KL divergence to the posterior, and then use the result as though it is the posterior. Okay? All right, I'm going to start skipping stuff, but let's get going. Okay, so let's look at that KL divergence. There questions?
No, excited to hear about it.
Okay. You're excited that we finally started the lecture. Okay. Do one of these.
I have kids, so these are really familiar to me.
Okay. Let's talk about this objective function, KL Q of Z nu against P of Z given X. This equals the expectation log Q of Z minus the expectation log P of Z I'm going to do the probability notation. So the capital Z is going to be the random variable. This is an expectation. This is the random variable. So this is a log Q. It's a distribution evaluated at big Z. This expectation is taken with respect to Q. Okay? So this is the quantity, the function of the random variable. This is the distribution of that random variable. Okay? All the expectations are going to be taken with respect to Q, so I'm going to drop the subscript, usually. Log P of Z given X, right? So you see that X is fixed, Z is random. Okay, that's the KL divergence. This is what we want to minimize. So we want to find the argmin of nu of this quantity and then use the resulting Q as a proxy. Okay. We had a good discussion in the first hour about intuitions around this KL divergence, so we'll skip those ideas for now. But basically know that I want to give you some different intuitions about what variational inference is trying to do. Okay? So this is the KL divergence. Now, it's a little funny, right? Because we cannot compute this posterior, right? If we could, then we wouldn't be doing this in the first place. We'd be doing something else right now. And so what variational inference does is it actually optimizes a different objective function that's equal to this plus an additive constant that doesn't matter when we are optimizing. All right, so let me just quickly derive that for you. So rewrite this as expectation Q log Q of Z given nu minus, now this is the posterior. Oh, I erased the posterior. The posterior, you know, is the ratio of the joint against the evidence. And so let's expand it that way. So this is expectation Q log P ZX minus plus log P of X. Right? This does not depend on Z, so there's no expectation there. And this is the expected log joint. And this is the expected log probability of Q. All these expectations are taken under Q. So in classical mean field variational inference, actually, I want to mention something, not to break the flow of this. But, you know, these ideas really, you know, when you spoke about physics, these ideas really came from physics. It was, what happened was, my understanding, it was just down the street, Mike Jordan was here, and he, Lawrence Saul, who at that point was called Larry Saul, he came to Mike's lab as a postdoc, I think from a physics degree, and brought with him a paper about mean field theory. And then they read that paper and Mike and his group were developing graphical models at that time. They read that paper and then adapted the mean field theory to do inference in graphical models. So that's really the history. It happened here in the late 90s. Okay, so back to reality. We've got
the Kale divergence here written this way. And now you can see this is a constant with respect to Q, so we don't need to worry about it. And we can optimize this, and this is in terms of quantities that we can compute. We can compute log P of Z and X. We can compute log of Q. We can set Q, so we set it up so that we can compute it. And we set things up so that we can compute these expectations as well. Okay? I brought up that history because the real quantity that we optimize, we don't minimize this quantity. This is going to seem like a waste of time. But what we do is we maximize this quantity. It's called the elbow. And it's just the negation of this. But I want to write it down for you, because if you start reading papers about variational inference, this is the quantity you're going to see. It's the expectation log P of Z and X minus expectation log Q of Z. And this is called the elbow. It stands for the evidence lower bound. It happens to be a lower bound on log P of X. That comes from Jensen's inequality. And in those early papers on variational inference, this is how you see that derived. But here I just derived it for you in an alternative way. We know that Kale divergence is positive, so we know that this bounds the log P of X. Okay, this is important. If you get one thing out of this lecture, this is the objective function you want to have in your mind. And so in variational inference, what do we do? Well, we negated the KL, so we want to maximize, we want to minimize the KL, we want to maximize this. That's equivalent to minimizing the KL. And now we can start to understand why, what variational inference is, okay? So there's a few comments I want to make about this objective function. Whew, I seem to have totally gone off the rails in my... Okay, don't know where I am. Okay. Comment number one. First I want to specify something. Okay, so we have not yet specified what Q is, right? We've left it totally unspecified. So let me specify it now. We're going to restrict Q so that we can compute these expectations. Okay? And so often we choose Q to be the mean field family. We'll get back to that in a second. Where Q of Z, given nu, where each hidden variable, let's say that Z contains, you know, M hidden variables. Each hidden variable is endowed with its own variational parameter and is independent. Okay, so this equals the product, I equals 1 to M. Let's say there are little M hidden variables. And we have Q of ZI with its own variational parameter, nu I. Now this seems like a weird thing, but I'm going to get back to that in a little bit. Okay, so this is the mean field family. And we set this up because in such a way that we can compute these expectations and compute this objective function. And then we optimize these nus in order to maximize this objective function, which is the same as finding the member of this family, this fully factorized family, that minimizes the Kale divergence to the exact posterior. Is that clear? Okay. This is the Ising distribution that you showed us, right? This is the exact same thing. Okay. This objective function has two terms, okay? This term is the entropy of Q, right? This term is how spread out Q is against, as a distribution of Z. If Q places its mass on lots of different configurations of Z, high mass, then it has high entropy. If it focuses on one configuration of Z, it has low entropy. This is the expected log joint, okay? But let's break this up with the chain rule. That is the expectation log P of Z plus the expectation log P of X given Z, little x given Z. Now, forgetting about the second term, if I only optimize this term, what would I want Q to be? Where would Q place its mass? Q is a distribution. It has to integrate to 1. So which configurations of Z would Q place its mass on if I only optimized this term? I see that I'm out of time, and I have like 4 hours left to go. So I'll just tell you, it's going to place its mass on the map estimates of Z. In other words, we're forgetting about this term. Here, it's going to want to place its mass on configurations of Z that explain the data. This is the likelihood,
right? It's likelihood of the data given a configuration of my hidden variables, and this is just the prior. So expectation log p of z and x, just if that were the only term, I would place my mass in q on configurations of the hidden variables z that maximize the likelihood loosely of the data. Okay, in the PSD case, if I were only to optimize this term, I would find map estimates of population proportions, population assignments, and population parameters themselves. So what this objective function is doing, essentially, is it's trying to find configurations of the hidden variables that explain the data, but it's tempering that with the entropy of the variational distribution, somehow pulling us away from a point mass at the map estimate into something that's more entropic. You can kind of see this as a regularization. When I talk about variational inference with statisticians, they tend to freak out at this. Okay, this seems like a really crazy thing to do. We're setting everything independent. And moreover, as a model, this is totally vacuous, right? As a model, there's no data here, so there's nothing to do. And everything is independent and governed with a free parameter. And the key idea here is that I'm setting up this distribution inside this objective function. This objective function connects these parameters new to the data and to the model that I'm positing. Okay, so let me draw that over here with the PSD model. Let me draw the mean field family here as a graphical model. You'll see that it's a vacuous graphical model. Here are their population proportions. They have a free parameter. We're going to call it lambda. Nope, we're going to call it gamma. Here are their, I'm going to not draw mother and father, I'll just draw one. Here are their population assignments, and they have variational parameters, phi. And there are, of course, L of them. And now, here are the population parameters. That have their own variational parameters. Okay, so this is like a vacuous thing. It's a bunch of latent variables, each with their own free parameters. There's nothing to do. It's unconnected to data and a model. It's connected to the data and the model through the elbow. What I do is I fit these squares so that this thing is close. Okay, so that connects these variational parameters to the posterior. And you can see that this is a very flexible distribution. Just like we can say that each little spin is got its own distribution, each person has their own distribution over their population proportions. Okay? And so I can capture that I'm part African, part European, that John is all African, that David is all European. I can capture that in this variational family because we each have our own gamma i's, our own distribution over those population proportions. Okay, I can capture that my fifth allele comes from this population, my ninth allele comes from that population, because each one is endowed with its own phi. But appreciate that this is a lot of parameters to fit if I have millions of people. Right? If I have a million people and each one has a million SNPs, then I have, is it a billion? No, it's a trillion variational parameters. I'll get to scalable variational inference. How do we fit this? All right, so first let's talk about the inefficient way to fit it, which is called coordinate ascent variational inference, or CAVI. All right, how do I fit this? Well, what I do is I have this big bank of variational parameters. And in coordinate descent variational inference, what I do is I hold them all fixed except for one, and I optimize that one. Then I hold them all the rest fixed except for one, and I optimize that one, and I repeat over and over again. Right? I march down this huge bank. Now remember, there are a trillion of them. That's fun to say. And I'm going to iteratively optimize each one. Okay? But in our general notation here, the update is very simple. Q star for zi, given nu I, is proportional to, so I want to set nu I such that q star is proportional to exp of expectation log, hold on, I'll write it and then I'll say it. This is cabby. So if I'm optimizing, I'm going to coordinate ascent optimize this KL divergence. If I'm going to optimize the ith variable, then its coordinate update is proportional to the exponentiation of the expected log joint, where this log joint contains, of course, the ith latent variable, contains the data, and contains all the other latent variables. This expectation is with respect to q minus I. I made up that notation now. That is just q with the ith variable fixed at little zi. Okay, and so notice the capital and lowercase letters here. This is an expectation with respect to z minus I, all the other latent variables except for the ith latent variable. Okay, this is the coordinate update that optimizes the KL divergence for the ith variable. A consequence of this, right, we know that the posterior, we know that conditionals are all proportional to the joint. And so a consequence of this is that I can write down that coordinate update in a different way. I'm going to do this in order to make a connection to you with Gibbs sampling. Q of zi nu I proportional to expectation log p of zi given z minus I and x. Nope. Okay. So it's the same as saying q of zi given nu i is proportional to this thing. And this is what I call the complete conditional. It's the conditional distribution of the ith latent variable given all the other latent variables and the observations. If you know about Gibbs sampling, then that is the thing you sample from when you do Gibbs sampling. So the original PSD paper sampled from these distributions iteratively in order to you know, that constructs a Markov chain whose stationary distribution is the posterior that you care about. But what this shows you is that the variational inference algorithm is not far away from that, right? The variational inference algorithm simply sets these coordinates to be something like those distributions that you sample from in the Gibbs sampler. And this also tells you how easy it is to derive a variational inference algorithm if you have these variables, if you have these distributions at the tip of your mind, right? If you can write down the model and you can write down the complete conditional for each latent variable, then with a little more effort, you can write down the variational algorithm, which tends to be faster than the Gibbs sampler, up to debate, and less accurate. So this is equal to this minus a constant. So since we have a constant of proportionality here anyway, that constant goes away. Yeah. Okay, that's cabby. And we could now do that with the PSD model, right? We could march down and we could fit the PSD model with variational inference. And here I believe this would be faster than the than the original algorithm that they used, and equally accurate. And the fast structure paper basically does that. Okay, so what's the problem? Let me get my notes again. Any other questions about cabby? And then we'll go on to scalable inference. Okay. And this is a widely used variational inference algorithm. So all of the papers that Nir was talking about that we can't write anymore, you know, in the 90s and 2000s, we would set up a model, we would derive the cabby algorithm, and we would publish a NIPS paper about it. Okay. There are details to deal with, too. So one detail is that this is not a convex objective function. So we're going to get to a local optimum when we use cabby. And so in practice, people restart many times from different starting places and then choose the best local optimum. And then there are fancier things that you can do to address the local optimum problem too, like tempering and other things. Okay. It's usually convex in single variables, but it's globally not convex. You get to a local optimum. Good. Okay, but what's the problem? Well, the problem is this. I started out with a random idea of my populations, and then I painstakingly analyzed all the individuals, and I have millions of them, and I have millions of sites, but that doesn't matter. It does matter, but we're pretending it doesn't matter. And I have millions of them, and so this is inefficient. And so stochastic variational inference builds on these results, but is an algorithm that where we subsample individuals, just grab five people or one person, analyze that person, update our idea of the ancestral populations, and repeat. And while CAVI is an optimization algorithm of this objective, the algorithm I just described for you is what's called a stochastic optimization algorithm of this objective. How many of you know what stochastic optimization is? Very few of you. Okay. So let me explain stochastic optimization. Our goal is to optimize this objective function. Now, David talked about people jumping off of cliffs. Everybody was deciding whether or not to jump off a cliff. Were you there for that? Okay. So he had it was a great Ising model analogy, people jumping off of cliffs. So my analogy for stochastic optimization is drunk people. Imagine you're here in Boston, you're trying to get to LA, and you're walking, and everybody's drunk. So what do? You ask John how to get to LA. John is drunk. He points in some direction. And while a normal person would not trust John, what you do is you walk 750 miles in that direction. You're in the middle of the country, hopefully, and you haven't just walked into the ocean. And you know, Scott's there, and you ask Scott, everyone's drunk, you ask Scott, how do I get to LA? And Scott points in some direction. Again, you shouldn't trust Scott, but what you do is you walk 350 miles in that direction. Now, you're somewhere else, maybe you're in Nevada, I hope. Nir is there, you ask Nir, how do I get to LA, and so on. Everybody's drunk, everybody's pointing in some direction. Each time you walk fewer and fewer steps in order to get to LA. And you can imagine, if you play the story out in your mind, or do it for real, that you would eventually get to LA. Right? You're eventually, if you take small and small and small steps, as long as if I could magically revive Scott each time he passes out and ask him how to get to LA, as long as the average of where he pointed to pointed directly at LA, then I would eventually get to LA. And that really is exactly what stochastic optimization does. Stochastic optimization, which is a beautiful old idea from 1950, says that if I take noisy gradients of an objective function that are cheap to compute, but have the right average, that on average, if I grab the noisy gradient many, many times, it would point at the right direction, then following noisy gradients eventually gets me to the optimum of my objective function. And this idea, as an aside, is basically enabling modern machine learning. So the reason that machine learning is doing anything right now is because of stochastic optimization. Because we can handle large data sets by subsampling the data sets when our gradient of our objective function is written down as a sum of terms, one for each data point. I can subsample terms, take a scaled gradient of that subsample, which is cheap, follow that gradient, and repeat. Repeatedly subsample, right? That is stochastic optimization. And I'm going to be sensitive to your patience and not derive it here for you now. I'll just assert to you that stochastic optimization of the elbow looks like this. Sample an individual. So at any point in this algorithm, I have estimates of my populations, okay? That's what I'm trying to fit. Sample an individual, update that individual's parameters of population proportions and population assignments. Okay, and you do that with your current idea of the populations. Now in CAVI, you would have to do that for all individuals before making progress. Here you just do it for one individual. Now, this is where it gets a little weird. Pretend that that individual is the only person in your population. So you know that movie, Being John Malkovich? Did you ever see that movie? It might be old. So remember, at some point, everybody is John Malkovich. Do the same thing. You grab John Malkovich from your data set, hopefully he's in there, and you figure out how he expresses the ancestral populations. Then you pretend that everybody is John Malkovich. And if everybody was John Malkovich, then ask yourself, what would the population parameters be in that setting, in that weird world? Okay? Now you're going to get something, we're calling it lambda hat. Set your current idea of the population parameters to be a little weighted average of your old idea and the idea where everybody is John Malkovich. Okay? So in other words, adjust them a little bit according to that that rule, and that's the walking in LA. Pretending everyone's John Malkovich, that's the drunk gradient, and then adjusting your current idea according to the world where everyone is John Malkovich is the step size. And that step size gets smaller and smaller according to certain conditions. If you do that, you get a very fast inference algorithm for this complicated model that can scale up to millions of people. And so that's how I got those results from the beginning of the talk. Thank you.